motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivated. Flow of wisdom on the mic with Sean.
Right, I hope you're motivated. Hour two, Flow of Wisdom. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Sean Anthony, and this is hour two on the humanization of robots. The humanization of robots, part one series, and I'm going to continue on for the next couple of weeks, maybe three. We'll see how it goes. But just laying down some foundational information today, and it's really interesting. I'm getting some responses already online. And on the Flow of Wisdom page, Facebook, Mark Russell, who's been a part of the show before. I've had him on as a guest. He's called in a few times as well. And he is the owner of thesingularity.com. Thesingularity.com. And I posted a video on the Flow of Wisdom page letting people know what I'm going to discuss, what I was going to discuss today. And he responded, he sent me a message. I just thought it was funny because it explains exactly what we're doing as far as the technology. So he sent me a video message, and this is what he said. Listen.
Sean Anthony, isn't it weird we can be talking about robots merging with us? And then, like, me and my wife are out here building a peacock pen. How is that even real, man? And I'm talking to you through, like, all of this technology, and we're doing a peacock fin.
He cut it all kind of short there. But I thought that was funny, and it's also cool. You know, listen, I don't want you guys to get it twisted that I'm some anti-technology guy. I think I've been pretty consistent, and I think I've been pretty vocal about my stance on technology. I've always been for the advancement of technology, and I love the evolution of it. I just have some concerns, valid concerns. Hell, if these people that are creating the technology have concerns, what's wrong with it with me having concerns, you know? But I think it's totally cool the fact that I post something on my page and he sends me a message as he's listening to the show. You know, and he's outside building a peacock fence or whatever he's doing with his family, and is able to send me a message via video, you know, and I'm able to share it with the thousands of many people that are listening to this broadcast live right now, and all the thousands more that are listening to it after the show is aired. Like, technology is cool. Don't get it twisted. I love the fact that I can communicate with people on the other side of the country via WhatsApp or some sort of Skype, you know, or just Viber, all of these different apps that you can use to communicate with people. However, because I'm so knee deep in this research, I also see the ramifications of some of the apps, the technology. So I have to try to put borders and boundaries around for myself as well. But going back to some of these premises of the growing problem of humanizing robots, it's written by an associate professor from the University of Michigan. His name is Lionel Robert, and I probably should reach out to him to see if I can get him on the show for next week. That would be really great. In fact, I'll do that after the show. Make a note. And to my peoples out there listening, send me a reminder, please. But I was talking about robots as lovers. And I gave you the case that's going on right now in Canada. Courts are processing the attempt to determine whether or not that this guy who was arrested because the robot that he ordered resembled a child. It was a sex robot, and he ordered it, and it resembled a child. So the courts are kind of going through this thing now. Is it legal or is it illegal? And it's really a slippery slope because, number one, the robot is not human. You know, however, going back to what I was saying earlier in the first hour, that when a robot resembles human-like qualities, it changes our human perception of that being, of that thing. It changes our perception of it. It's a human quality. Most good spirit, let me phrase it like this, most good spirited human beings don't like to see other human beings hurt or mistreated. However, I don't know what's going on with society now, man. This is some really, really, I don't know. I just don't get off on people that like to watch violent videos, watching people fighting, watching people getting jumped, you know, watching somebody getting hurt. And I say this all the time. I constantly, well, every so now and then, I got to check some of my friends. Don't send me that stuff. And again, their intent, I don't know what their intent is or what, but I have friends that, you know, I love dearly, but I have to put a stern line in the ground and say, do not send me anything violent. Because just for me, how I've been since I was a child, I'll never forget growing up when I was in living in Camden, New Jersey. And my mother and I, we were riding by Camden High School. And outside was a big crowd of students. And mind you, I was a kid. I was probably in elementary school. But I'll never forget this. This just stuck with me. But the kids were fighting. Two kids were fighting. And I was in damn near tears. Like, Mom, please make them stop fighting. I don't like to see harm done on people, you know, especially if it's innocent. Now, if I'm defending my family or defend, you know, preserving my life or anything like that, that's different. I'm willing to die to protect mine. But when I see innocent people getting hurt, it's a human quality that I possess. I'm sensitive to that, you know. So with all that being said, that's a pretty much human-like quality. Most people, most caring people, don't want to see others get hurt or harmed. Therefore, when you put on the synthetic skin of a robot or the fur of a robot where it looks like an animal and you see someone mistreating it, then that changes. That's a psychological effect. You understand what I'm saying? So this stuff goes very, very deep, much deeper than what we may believe or understand. And then I talked about the brothels and stuff that they have overseas, and they have these places. Hell, the whole show Westworld is a virtual world where anything goes. You can have sex with whoever you want to have sex with, where you can shoot and kill who you want to shoot and kill. You can, you know, take out who it's a wealthy human virtual video game, but in real life. That's what the television show Westworld is like. And you get emotionally connected because what you're looking at through your human eye is showing you that this is a human being, when in fact it's not. It's almost like a psychological deception, if you will. It's pretty crazy stuff. So let's go back. Let's talk about premise. The second premise that the professor mentioned in his paper talked about robots as citizens. Think about that. Robots as citizens. The more humanized robots become, the more we might expect them to assume human responsibilities in our society. And he points out the fact that Bill Gates proposed, I don't know if you guys remember this, might have been a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago, that a temporary robot tax for companies that employed them to replace human workers. And it was dismissed. But imagine taxing robots permanently in much the same way we do humans. Now, if we want to talk about taxes, I'm sure for tax the robots and not the humans. I'd rather do that. But, hey, that's something that, you know, we got to deal with here in America, in the United States. But imagine that. Robots being permanently taxed. The idea, of course, he points out, it seems far-fetched. You know, now because many of the robots replacing humans come in the physical form of faceless machines with robotic arms. When you go into, you know, a power plant or an assembly factory, and you see, like an assembly line, you see the robotic arms moving car parts and moving this piece of equipment and this and a third, you really don't have no connection to it. You don't feel sympathetic to it, you know. But he poses the question, imagine looking across a manufacturing plant and seeing hundreds of fully autonomous human-like robots at workstations once occupied by human employees. This is the trajectory we are heading for. Picturing manufacturing plants teeming with such robots may make the idea of taxing robots seem much more plausible to the average taxpayer. Think about it. How would you guys feel if you seen, you know, these robots looking like humans at your job? Looking just like a human being. How would you respond to that? My voice is getting scratchy. Have to get some tea. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll be back with more on Floor of Wisdom. All right, welcome back to Floor of Wisdom. The tea water is boiling. I didn't get a chance to get it done during that commercial break, but during this after this segment, I'll be able to get the tea and get my voice warmed up a little bit. But yeah, I welcome back to Floor of Wisdom. I'm your host, Sean Anthony, talking about the humanization of robots. 877-300-7645. Let's get these callers in. Be a part of the show. What are your thoughts on some of the information we've laid out so far? 877-300-7645. Do you think that these robots should be taxed? Do you think that they should be considered some sort of citizens? I mean, what are your thoughts on this? Do you think that the bond between humans and robots can be too close? Let's go to Atlanta. We got Leroy. Wants to talk about dehumanization of humans. Leroy, welcome to Floor with him. What's up, man?
That's right. I just pulled the rug right from under him.
Not so much the robots, but the humans. Go ahead.
Yeah. It's an attack on humankind, like Trudeau told the women's group up in Canada. It's not mankind, it's peoplekind. So we got to look out for these machines.
There you go.
Man, what I got to say about it, man, I mean, it's super weird. You know, these machines, by trying to attach these human traits and emotions and things that we do, I mean, that's why I came with that. It's the dehumanization of humans. Because for you to speak on people having so much of an attachment to a machine that they don't want to send it into battle, no, it's supposed to be the opposite way. Go. Send more. Instead of me, I'm flesh and blood. I get to live while that is destroyed. Because like you said, you can't kill something that isn't alive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, you know, it should be the other way around. But, I mean, just think about the psychological effects. As I was saying earlier, Leroy, it changes when these machines look human. It just does something to us psychologically. I can't quite explain, but it's mental. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. Look, I saw an interview yesterday of the guy that runs Hanson Robotics. I forgot his first name, but it was on Beyond Innovation, and he, man, this is how far gone these people are. He was saying that Well, yeah, we need, just like Elon Musk, we need to be careful and make sure that we're having a discussion about what the effects are, both good and bad, especially a discussion. His emphasis was on a discussion about what could go wrong. But when you say discussion, that's great. Where's the part where we do something? Because if you're just talking about it, then you ain't really talking about doing ish. Know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah, I mean, it's a game, and a very dangerous game. And I hope everybody's sitting down for this, what I'm about to say, because I wasn't really ready for it when I thought of it. Women, I'm really praying for y'all, because I don't want y'all to fall for it more, because there are relations between men and women. Both can only go so far, you know, as far as physical. But with a machine, there is no stopping until you say stop. Get what I mean?
Oh, yeah. And that's why I said that this is going to be a series, Leroy, because you wait till the stuff that I drop next week. Like, I haven't touched anything what I'm going to talk about next week, because I knew that this week was enough just to lay down a foundation. But you're on to something, because how far is too far? And when I start getting into the skin and then the artificial brain that they're working on, as well as the reproductive organs, like, I'm just mentioning it now, but wait till I lay out the research next week and the following week after. Like, it's crazy. But yeah, you're talking about Hanson Robot, Dr. David Hanson. He's the creator of Sophia and Hanson Robotics. Man, look, based out of China. Yeah.
Look, when he was doing the interview, I think he might have blinked twice.
It's quite weird, man. But listen, thanks for the call, Leroy. I got to take a break, and I got to run and get my tea for this next segment, man. Yes, sir. All right, man. Thanks for the call. That's Leroy in Atlanta, 877-300-7645. Call in. Let me know your thoughts. We'll be right back after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I got my tea. Ladies and gentlemen, I have my tea. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom. I'm your host, Sean Anthony, talking about the humanization of robots. And what an interesting subject we are covering today, and we will cover in the next coming weeks. 877-300-7645. Another caller from Atlanta. We've got Mark talking about merging with AI. Is this Mark Russell?
This is Mark Russell, Sean Anthony. This time I'll ask you, how art thou?
How art thou? Thou art wonderful, man. How art thou?
So, I'm doing awesome, man. Enjoying Sean Anthony's show, Flow of Wisdom, and out here, which is just crazy to me, Sean, that literally I am out here in my backyard with my wife, peacock pen, okay? Now, here's the crazy. Listen to this. You ready? Here it goes. That is a nail gun. And here's what's so weird, and it's my point. How can I be out in nature with you in my ears, interacting with you? How is that? You're on the other side of the world. How is that even possible? And the point is this: when we look at merging with computers and AI, here's my question. A lot of our questioning that or analyzing that comes from a perspective that it will be this or that. But look at how you and I are getting along right now. We've kind of merged into it. We've kind of eased into it. And we don't find this this interaction so crazy, even though when you think about it, it is really crazy.
Right.
That I can be on the other side of the world and be talking to you on a Bluetooth through a cell phone, using a nail gun, and out in nature.
Right.
So what if, and this is the only idea for the day. What if, as we go forward, all of our debates, what if it's more gradual? What if we merge with AI? What if What if the, I hate to say this, but what if the chips go into our brain, and rather than it being AI and us being separate, what if we become one with the AI?
Yeah.
That's, and I'm only using the pattern from what's happening right now to kind of throw that out there.
Well, that's the evolution of it, Mark. I mean, you've been on the show. You've been vocal about it. I've been vocal about it. I mean, you're the man behind thesingularity.com, and that's the imminent evolution of this merging of humans and AI is the singularity moment, where the two become intertwined and or that AI becoming smarter than humans. I think that's the caution that the people are putting out there. You know, the sentient moment when AI becomes, you know, can outwit and outsmart humans.
And that would be a separate, that's a separate scenario, because it's them and us. I'm only suggesting, what if it's Ray Kurzweil talks about that we merge with it.
Gotcha.
And then it becomes us being one.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that, like, right now our spirits, if you will, Sean, are one, even though our flesh is on two separate sides of the world. Mm-hmm. And the more we merge, I think the more people's spirits all around the world will become one. So anyway, that's it, Sean.
Hey, Mark, I appreciate you, man. I love that message you sent, man. I had to share it, man.
All right. Talk at you.
Yes, sir. Later,
take
man. That's Mark in Atlanta. He's got a site. It's called thesingularity.com, 877-300-7645. Wow. Not too often we get calls from Ohio. We got John wants to talk about robots in Ohio. John, welcome to Flow of Wisdom.
Hey, Sean. How's it going, bro?
Good.
We communicate. You might know me as Mobato 242, but I'm the same guy. So
what's up, man? Yeah, good to finally have you on the show. What's going on, man?
Nothing, man. Just been enjoying your show, man. For the longest, the last couple of topics you've been on has just been pouring on. But you know what's so troubling about this whole AI transhumanism? Like you said, technology in and of itself is not a bad thing. But what is it used for, and how is it used against us, or how is it used nefariously? Mm-hmm. And I was watching a TV last night. A commercial came on where someone they had this diabetes tester. You didn't have to stick yourself, but you had a little thing that stuck on your arm, and you just waved your measuring thing over it, and it gave you your readout. So how far are we from not having that thing stuck on your arm to having a chip in you?
Mm-hmm.
And,
very
you know,
close.
People just aren't. Yeah, exactly. You see how it's getting so close. But it amazed me the number of people that just aren't thinking about this or aren't aware of it. You know, they think that spending this billions of dollars on 5G is just so we can have faster download speeds. You know, it's. But I'm glad you're bringing light to this stuff, man, because it's definitely not talked about in some circles, and
yeah.
It needs to be.
John, man, were you the one who sent me the link to about Russia plans to set up a moon base inhabited by avatar robots?
Yep, sure.
Yes.
Did, man. I sent you one a while too about Kindred AI when it was kind of new on the scene.
Yeah, I've done shows on Kindred AI. In fact, we're going to touch on Kindred AI on because I'm going to talk about this subject next week as well, because I've got articles. I've got, I don't know, maybe another four or five articles that I haven't even picked up to talk about on this show. But Kindred AI is one of them. And, yeah. Thanks for sending that.
Yeah.
Keep sending me stuff, too, John. Go ahead.
I will, too, man. I will. Thanks for having brother Robert X on, man. That dude is, his breadth of knowledge is just crazy. Every time I hear, listen to him, I hear stuff that I have to go back and listen two and three times to just digest it and read it and pick it up, man. But, yeah, I appreciate that brother, man, because he puts it down. He tells it like it is.
Yes, sir. Man, Robert X is the truth, man. And mind you, imagine having personal conversations with him. Like I
know.
I hang
up
the phone.
We know know a lot of the same people here in Columbus.
Really? Oh, you're in Columbus?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm pretty sure I know a lot of people here, man. I went to high school here and college, so yeah.
Yeah, man. But yeah, this first time I called in, I'll try to get in a little more often, man. But I just listen to you, bro, because you're filling a space that needs to be filled with information, and you're putting it out there. You're not opinionated with it. You do your research, and you put it out there and entice people to go do their own research and further it. So. That's a plus, man. Appreciate you.
Thank you, John. I appreciate you, man. And stay in touch, man. And I'd love to hear you call back on the show, man. That's John in Ohio. That's pretty cool. 877-300-7645. You know, and we connected through social media. I know him under another alias, you know, but we connect through social media. And that's the first time I had a conversation with him. And he sends me stuff from time to time as well. You know, some of it I've already been, you know, I've checked it out already. I've already seen it or what have you. And then there's some things that I have not. And I've never been the one to be too prideful of like, nah, because the article he sent me just this past week, he asked me, have I seen it? And sent me the link. And I was like, I have now because of you. And thank you. You know, and I read it. And then I posted it. So if you guys want to check out that, it's a really interesting article on how Russia is planning to set up a moon base inhabited by avatar robots. It's crazy stuff. But that's Russia News, Russia Today, RT News. But it's on the Floor of Wisdom page on Facebook. Check it out. It's really crazy. 877-300-7645. A couple of other things, you know, before we wrap up this show, that some of the things that we're going to cover next week, okay? I will tell you, we're going to touch on, and this is something that I know for certain, I've covered several numerous times on this show, but we're going to talk about it in a lot more depth, the skin, some of the aesthetics going on with these robots to make them look more human. But there was a Stanford engineer that has made stretchable, flexible skin that looks and feels just like human skin straight out of Westworld. Straight out of Westworld. Also, I've talked about this before, but I've never laid it in context with under this one subject of the humanization of robots. A new soft robotic skin automatically heals itself even if you shoot it full of holes. We'll talk about that next week. That's in futurism. Also, I have plans to talk about this article today. I even got the highlights and you know, wrote notes on it and everything. But I've talked about this article before. The Human Upgrade, Thought Process, Building an Artificial Brain. And this is by Paul Allen. Paul Allen is the co-founder of Microsoft. Crazy stuff. 877-300-7645. Let's get these callers right in. Come on, guys. You guys call in a little sooner before, you know, we wrap up the show, because I love getting your guys' perspective. We got Alan in Texas on the line. Alan wants to talk about nanotechnology in DNA strands. Alan in Texas, welcome to Floor of Wisdom, man.
Yeah, good afternoon, Sean. Yeah. Hey, I don't know if I brought this up when I called, you know, it's been a while back, but, you know, I was talking with Dr. Wynn Parker when he was on, before he kind of disappeared, and I was asking him about synthetic DNA, and I'd seen where they had, you know, created synthetic DNA, and he didn't really answer that question, but he said, well, no, but the Japanese have just announced that they've incorporated nanocircuitry into the DNA strand. Mm-hmm. So is the next step in this whole robot-human thing actually going from a true robot to a human robot, a robot human, whatever you want to do? I mean,
Alan,
do with that?
Hang on, Alan. I got to take a quick break. I want to keep you on the line because to answer your question briefly, yes, I believe so, because this is something we're going to cover in the upcoming show on this subject. in this series. So hang on the line. Let me take a quick break and get Alan back from Texas so he can finish out his thoughts and his questions, y'all. Don't go anywhere. It's Flow of Wisdom. Welcome back to Flow of Wisdom. I am your host, Sean Anthony. We got Alan in Texas. Alan, thank you for being patient, man, during that commercial break. You were talking about nanotechnology in DNA strands, basically synthetic DNA. Go ahead and finish with your thoughts, man. What were you saying?
Well, you know, it's just, anytime one of these things, you start hearing about it, you know, I know you think about this. You know, there are several different ways. They don't ever come at a project with just one thing in mind. You know, there are, you know, down the road things that are being planned. And, you know, if you kind of study the patterns the way they brought things in the past, you can almost kind of predict to a point, you know, what's going to, you know, kind of what they're working towards in the future. And, you know, like I said, with this DNA and, you know, the circuitry incorporated actually into the codons, into the, you know, of the DNA strand, I mean, what could that do? Could they that be able to allow them to switch on and off a particular allele, you know, the unit of genetic inheritance, and be able to create a morphing life form, semi-life form? You know, very strange things in the future. The technology is kind of scary.
Yeah, it's daunting to some regards. You know, even something we're going to cover next week, maybe we'll have time, but there's scientists that has created a robot that gets a menstrual cycle. Have you heard of that, Alan?
No, but it does not surprise me, Sean.
Yeah, it's called Avatar. I brought it up on the show maybe a year or two ago, but I'm going to include that research in this series of Humanization of Robots. But just think about that. And even the play on the names, Eve. It looks like Evatar or Avatar, however you want to say it. But they created this robot that develops menstrual cycles and periods. And granted, now they're doing this research to benefit and to help, you know, it's for research to help women with menstrual cycles and so on and so forth. We'll get into that next week, but it's crazy when you start looking at some of the things that they are developing. It's really, really mind-boggling.
Oh, yeah. And I'll let you get on with your show here, Sean. Like I said, I love it, man. I wish there was more shows out there talking about technology. So you've got a definite niche there that's being filled, and you do a great job.
Thank you, Alan. I appreciate it, man. 877-300-7645. Alan in Texas. I appreciate it. Guys, thank you for the calls. Thank you for listening. Thank you for those sharing the links on social media sites. Very, very interesting. Like I said, I just gave you some information, just some groundwork today, some foundational information, what we're going to build upon in the next coming weeks. I would say two more weeks, we should be able to get bulk of this information out. A lot of these articles I've had for quite some time and just used for merely to add to whatever subject matter that I was covering in the past. But I think it's only right to really focus in on the humanization of robots, because it's inevitable. This is the direction that we are going. When you look at how all the technology developed today and how it all lines up with our day-to-day lives, imagine it being a human-like robot as opposed to, you know, some robotic-looking device. For example, like the Amazon Alexa or the Google thingy thing, whatever they use, you know, all of these, you know, devices that you have in your home and you talk to it. Hey, Amazon Alexa, play Flow of Wisdom Radio. Imagine it walking and being an assistant to you. Imagine robots to help the elderly, you know, to assist them so that, you know, there's you don't have health care, you know, health expenses as far as having a nurse there to help the elderly or the disabled. Like, these are things that we really strongly have to consider. You know, we strongly have to consider, because on one hand, it definitely can assist us and make our lives easier. On the flip side, you know, like John in Ohio said, could this possibly be a gateway for someone to hack and to use this technology for some nefarious reason, you know, to harm others? And I've given examples about that before last week as well. The television shows to show you how these, you know, how it can play out. You know, that's the thing about entertainment, movies and TV shows. You know, whether you look at it as reality or not, it can show you an example of things to come. Okay? An example of things to come. Well, look, all that being said, I hope y'all have a great week. I'm going to continue sipping on this tea and rest my voice. And I hope you all will check me out next Sunday. We'll be live again, Lord willing, 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on the Genesis Communications. FloorOfWisdom.com. Get connected with me there. Live life, get wisdom, and let it flow. I'm Sean Anthony. This is Floor of Wisdom. Peace. Motivated, hip-hop motivated, flow of wisdom on the mic with Sean Anthony. Motivated.